So far as stock filing is concerned, I would like to know from the Finance Minister below, government has any plan on stock filing in the interests of India? Supposing war breaks out and the situation worsens, it will be necessary for government to depend on many vital things which the country itself does not produce. I did not discover in the budget any plan for spending any money for a planned stock filing in the interest of India's national economy. I do not know if there are any secret plans going on which the Finance Minister has not disclosed. I shall now refer to the Indo-Pak Agreement. I will not go into details at the present moment. I may have time to do so in the course of the discussion on demands for grants, but frankly speaking, so far as this agreement is concerned, nothing could have been more humiliating for India than the manner in which this agreement was effected. If India wanted to have such an agreement, India could have made it long ago on much better terms and saved a lot of humiliation and misery to millions of people. But India deliberately wanted to pursue a particular line of policy which was consistent with our national interest, and overnight that policy was changed. Whether it was due to far-sighted or short-sighted statesmanship, or due to defeatism or cowardice, I do not know. But it has left a bad taste in the mouth of all, because the country feels that it has been let down by its government. So far as the economic policy of the government is concerned, I hope we shall have an opportunity of discussing this matter when the details of the budget will be taken up. But food, clothing and shelter are the three main things on which government's failure is colossal, and on which the country expects a new lead from the government if it is to function with the willing confidence and cooperation of the people. Today we are living in very difficult circumstances. I have no desire merely to blame the government or accuse the government, because we are trying to solve a problem of a magnitude which perhaps has had no parallel in any other part of the world. But the way in which the government is pursuing its policy is not the way in which a solution will be found. Somehow the gap between the government and the people is increasing rapidly day by day. It is no use government blaming the activities of particular groups. There may be such parties who may create trouble. We must keep in mind that it was still the foreign government that was at the helm of affairs, and the terms of reference of these ad hoc tariff boards were very limited in their character. For example, before any industry could be considered to be entitled for the grant of protection, it was essential that there should be abundant natural resources for that industry available in the country itself. There should be a local market for its produce. There should be real potentialities for its development on its development at a rapid pace. Even then, the protection was afforded only for limited periods, and that too only in cases where a certain industry could stand foreign competition. These were the limitations, but even in this limited sphere, we have several illustrations which show that the government of that day never accepted the recommendations of these tariff boards when they clashed with the interests of foreign capitalists, particularly British capitalists in this country. In 1928, the government refused to grant any protection to the locomotive manufacturing industry on the lame excuse that there was no market for it in India. We know how crores and crores of rupees had to be spent for buying locomotives outside the country, and even today we are importing these locomotives from abroad. Thus, we see that when these tariff boards were appointed for the first time, they functioned in a very halting and indecisive manner, and they were intended only for the protection of the interests of foreign capitalists and not for the development of indigenous industries. Then came the war. From 1939 up to 1945, the policy of the government was to maintain the protection already afforded by giving fresh lease to life to the Protective Duties Act. It was in November 1945 that the then government appointed an interim tariff board which extended life is still working, and which tariff board is thought to be replaced by the tariff commission, it will be said, in this piece of legislation. This bill incorporates very important provisions which fall into three categories. Firstly, Chapter 2 deals with the establishment of the commission, its personnel and constitution, the qualifications of the members and the chairman, and also the terms of office and tenure of service of the members and the chairman.